Good evening and welcome to the planning committee. I'm sorry that a few of you are going to have to stand there, but hopefully it won't be too long for you. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the table here tonight are, to my immediate right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people you see on both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not be allowed to take part in any debate that may be followed by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. The order of tonight's agenda may vary subject to the numbers of people who are here in relation to a specific agenda item, and subject to the committee agreeing to the order being varied. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, then that matter will not be discussed this evening, and will be discussed at a subsequent meeting. Okay, could we have approval of the minutes, please?
Yes, yes, very much happy.
Thank you. Are there any declarations of interest? No? Thank you. Are there any requests for site visits? David?
Yes, thank you, Chair. I'd like to move a site visit for item 6, which is the east side of Kidnos Road, Greenby. We did visit this site 3 years ago in relation to a much smaller development than the one that's being proposed. And I believe that we need to take into context the area in the process of what this application is all about, and read in the context of the adjacent property. We really can't do that from the notice from the application detail provided with the agenda. So I'd like to move the site visit.
Thank you, Chair. I'm requesting a site visit for agenda item number 11, 32 Wirral Road, North Tourdom, which is in relation to the development of changes to the to the water property.
Thank you, Dave. Any others? Can I just ask the committee if we're happy to have those two site visits?
Thank you.
In view of the fact that the committee have decided to do site visits on agenda item 6, which is the land to the east side of the Kilmarnock Road and Realey and Wirral Road and Torum, we won't be discussing that any further this evening until we've had the site visit. So anybody who would like to leave can leave now. And those of you who are left who haven't got seats, would you like to move forward? That would be great. Committee, we do have a petition on agenda item 12. Are we happy to take agenda item 12 first and then reverse order? Okay, so we'll be looking at agenda item 12 first, which is pages 57 to 60, 14, Markham Avenue, Hodson. Matthew, do you have a presentation, please?
for a two-storey rear extension, which will also allow for the loft to be converted into a bedroom with a bathroom. Two side dormers would be erected, which would sit back from the front of the house, and as such would not adversely harm the character of the dwelling or street scene when viewed from Barkham Avenue. The ground floor element could be built under permitted development, and the first floor element is set 3.2 metres off the shared boundaries. Therefore, the impact of the development is not considered to warrant a refusal of the planning permission. The main outlook for the proposal would be in a north-facing direction and down the applicant's garden. Properties to the rear on Wallasey Lane comfortably exceed minimum separation distances. Two small windows and side dormers relate to an ensuite bathroom and stairwell, both of which are not habitable rooms and both of which would give skilled delays and secure air conditioning. Having regard to what could be built under permitted development and to the fact that the first floor elements are set in from the adjacent boundaries, the proposals are considered to be acceptable and are recommended for approval. There is a qualifying addition of objection in connection with this application.
Would like the lead petitioner like to speak on this?
Yes.
Okay, would you like to come forward? You just sit on this desk here, please. There should be a button on the monitor there that you can press to turn the microphone.
Yeah.
Okay. If you can say your name and your address, and then you have up to 5 minutes to present to the committee.
My name's Norma Isles. I live at number 12, Larkham Avenue. And this extension will cut out all my daylight from the conservatory. And all the evening sunshine will just go. We did submit a document of consultation from a planning consultant. I don't know if the council has seen it. Which explains the closest of number 14 extension to my house. There's only 0.9 of a metre between number 14 and the boundary. My property will be very disadvantaged by this extension. Very disadvantaged.
Thank you very much.
Actually,
line that represents the boundary of the property. So at ground floor level, the extension is set off a little less than a metre on that side, but over a metre on the other side. But as the applicant has alluded to, we have had discussions with them, and so the extension has been set back considerably at first floor level. There are boundary fences that run down the perimeter of the site. Number 12 is slightly elevated, so it sits higher than the application property. I know you've kept alluded to impact on the conservatory, but the conservatories are not considered to be habitable rooms in planning terms, so therefore any impact on the conservatories, the way that we can afford that is diminished because they're not habitable rooms. But just to point out that the windows on both sides, here and here, would be obscurely glazed, so there wouldn't be any overlooking. We have done an assessment, a 45 degree assessment, in terms of potential loss of light, and the application passes both tests for elevation and plan.
Thank you,
Matthew.
Christina?
Could I just ask, you say that the windows are obscured, but do they open?
Openable above 1.7 metres, so only the top part of the window would open.
So it's still effectively so overlooked.
Well, you'd have to stand on the ladder, but you can't actually count it, yes.
Why do you have to stand on the ladder?
Because it's 1.7 metres high.
The windows?
Yeah, the openable bit. Not the whole window won't open, it's only the top bit, and it would be top hung.
Well, why would you have to?
I can't
see to the
idea. I'm
tempted to accept that
you
stand on the ladder. I don't normally
when
I'm counting my window.
But the point of 1.7 metres is that the majority of people, even me at 1.8 metres, wouldn't be able to see at 1.7 out of that window.
Okay. Thank you. Dave?
Just a very quick comment. I'm concerned that the objector's concerned about the loss of light. And of course, if you look at the plan on page 57, you will see that the only loss of light that number 12 is likely to lose would be in the late evening, probably in autumn or summer, when the light from next door's garden would go straight into number 12. The sun just moves around in a circle around the house, so it's going to be the actual difference. On the house itself, number 12 is in way of its own light of its own back garden, and view from the south, so that is hardly relevant. I'm just asking Matthew, as the officer, lead officer here, whether he believes that has been taken into account sufficiently to avoid the loss of light, because you mentioned that the conservatory itself is not a habitable room, and therefore that is understandable. My only concern about this application was that fear of the loss of light, which probably would only take place late evening, maybe, but it is a significant feature in terms of the loss of amenity to the lady next door.
Yeah, as I said before, we've done an assessment, a 45 degree rule assessment, which is done really to measure any potential loss of light, daylight or sunlight. And because it's been set back at first floor level, that reduces the impact of the extension even further. So the assessment that we've done does pass both on elevation and plan, so that would demonstrate that there would be no loss of light or sunlight.
Thank you.
Reference is made under the paragraph introduction that amended plans were requested in order to address concerns of the neighbouring amenity. Can we be told what the differences that were made?
I just mentioned that the setback at first floor and the windows have been reduced.
Thank you.
Denise? Now I'd like to agenda item 4, please, referring to the normal order. Thank you.
garage is here, and then the two proposed dwellings here at the front. And then you can just, this black line here represents number 176 Bonston Road, just to put that plan in context. This application was subject to a vendor site visit on Monday. And planning permission is sought for the demolition of the existing dwelling and the erection of two new detached dwellings together with the retention of the existing garage. The application is an outline one with appearance, landscaping and scale reserved for subsequent approval. At this stage, only approval of access and layout is sought. The site is located within an area allocated as an infill village within the Greenbelt. Proposals for new infill development are permitted, subject to criteria for new housing set out in policy HS4 being satisfied. An earlier proposal for three terrace dwellings on site was withdrawn by the applicant following advice from the local planning authority that these proposals could not be supported. This amended proposal for two detached dwellings is considered to be a more acceptable proposal. The dwellings indicated are similar in scale to adjacent plots with similar footprints proposed. The existing garage is to be retained. That was approved in March 2006 with a condition imposed restricting its use as ancillary to the occupiers of 178 Barnston Road. If planning permission for this application is granted, a similar condition would be imposed to restrict its use as ancillary to the second dwelling as shown on the proposed layout plan. And so that's this one here. This is to ensure the building cannot be used as a separate unit of accommodation. Due to the potential impact on protected species and or habitat, a habitat survey has been submitted and assessed by Rural Wildlife, who conclude the development would not adversely impact on habitat or species, including bats. Separation distances between dwellings are achieved and habitable room windows would not experience any loss of light or outlook. Off-street parking provision is shown for both the dwellings and access arrangements are considered to be acceptable. The introduction of two smaller dwellings in place of the existing single dwelling, which has a larger footprint, is considered to be acceptable, resulting in no harm or on the openness of the greenbelt. Planning policy states that such limited infill development will not compromise the purposes of the greenbelt. The proposals are considered to be acceptable and are recommended for approval. There is a qualifying petition of rejection.
Would the petitioner like to come forward to speak on this?
Yeah. office. There's therefore an unacceptable packing of the site, resulting in a density that is out of keeping with the environment and the proximity to 176 Barnston Road, which will mean a significant loss of privacy. There are appearance and amenity issues to do with this submission, and the footprint is practically doubled if this application goes ahead. The indicative drawings show that the footprint of the two properties, excluding the decking, approximately double that of the existing bungalow. On the submitted plan, the footprint of the existing bungalow and that of the two proposed houses has been highlighted. It shows clearly that the footprint is basically doubled. Because the land falls dramatically, and this is in the officer's report, the land of number 2 Homewood Drive, which backs onto the property, is substantially lower than that of 178 Barnston Road. This will result in the houses being substantially higher and closer to 2 Homewood Drive than the existing bungalow. This will result in significant loss of amenity and would be harmful and would have a harmful impact on 2 Homewood Drive. Within the Green Belt, there's a general prescription against inappropriate developments. In order to retain the open appearance of the Green Belt, it is important to prevent replacement buildings being materially larger than the original dwellings. The erection of 2 new detached properties, 4-bedroom houses, the retention of the additional accommodation annex, which is the garage, described on the plans as a garage, the development of the access points all present a materially larger development than the currently located on the site. The National Planning Policy Framework and Rural Unitary Development Plan Policies GB2 and URM1 require that the developments must not be inappropriate and be in keeping with the local area. The objectors feel that this hasn't been met. Unless Rural Borough Council's stated policies about rural areas are just comfortable words with no substance behind them, the Planning Committee surely must reject on these grounds along the application. The submission to the Planning Committee also states the indicative plan shows dwellings 2 stories in height with integral garages. But there's no integral garages on the original plan. The objectors just want to highlight that. So on these grounds, Chair, I'd like the committee to consider the impact on local environment and reject this application. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. If you could turn up your microphone for me, please. I'm going to open this up to the committee now. Have you got any comments or questions?
Can I just ask you? Can I just get some clarity on this? The application of Munster's proposal is just about our county building, it's not 2 stories.
Through you, Chair. At this stage, it's an outline application, so what's fixed at this stage is the layout. So where those two dwellings are shown on the plan, and that's fixed at this stage, and access to the site. They're the only 2 things that we're approving if the application is approved tonight. They would be the only 2 matters that are approved. Scale, appearance, and landscaping are reserved for subsequent approval. So there are indicative drawings that have been submitted that show 2-story dwellings. And there are 2-story dwellings adjacent to the site to the south and to the north. But we're not approving 2-story dwellings at this stage.
That was obviously come to the committee again for permission.
Thanks, Chair. Can the Planning Officer just advise the Planning Committee
not policy GB2 that this application should be assessed against. It's policy GB6 and GB7, because this is a designated infill development within Greenbelt. So that policy says infill development is acceptable subject to the criteria set out in policy HS4, which relates to new housing.
Can I say what's something on density? Because that's actually what I think.
Thank you to the chair. I mean, density used to be a material consideration that weighed quite heavily when we considered planning applications, particularly when we had the regional spatial strategy that was still in force. Because of changes to national planning policy, so PPG3, which used to reference density, has been removed, and the regional spatial strategy, then weight to be afforded to density issues is significantly diminished. But if you look at the properties to the south of the site on your location plan on page 7, and again those properties on Homewood Lane, two properties on this site are not out of character when you look at the densities of other plots in the area.
Finally, Chair, with regards to my good invasion of privacy in 176, were tests carried out for the
company? Again, through you, Chair, there's only one window on that first floor level on the gable elevation of 176, which relates to, as I understand it, a bedroom. That's a secondary window, and the principal window is on the rear of the property, which looks in an easterly direction. There are windows on the ground floor, but they are already obscured by the presence of a 1.8 metre high fence and a boundary hedgerow, and so impact on those windows, and we can't take account of that because of the fact they're already obscured by the boundary treatment.
Thank you, Matthew. Dave?
Thank you very much, Chair, for a informative site visit. It was especially to myself, but especially when I asked to go and look in the back and realising, as the Board Council said, it's a valley sort of on the perimeter of the property. But when you look at the size of the plot itself, taking the front and the rear gardens, in consideration to 174, 172, yeah, 170, 168, the size of the plot that's available is larger than those that were. Given that there's a tree preservation order on the site itself, I find great difficulty in finding a reasoned argument to refuse the application that's in front of us. I fought tooth and nail for against infill in Greenbelt in my own particular ward, and I know the changes in the legislation have taken place make it harder for local authorities to do that. I believe what's in front of us is an excellent application.
Given that this is GB6 and GB7, so it comes under
CHS 4, which deals with the criteria that's set out for new housing development. That deals with things like layout and character of the area, access, impact on neighbours. And we assess that application against what CHS 4 and we feel it's an appropriate form of development.
Okay, thank you. The officer's recommendation is to approve, and Dave has actually moved approval. Do you have a seconder? Denise seconded. All those in favour of the officer's recommendation to approve, subject to the conditions listed. Those against? Any abstentions? Okay, that's carried. Thank you. We now move to agenda item 5, pages 17 to 22, planting machinery at the Wallasey. Matthew, can we have a presentation, please?
Planning Commission is the law for the change of use of a warehouse to a gym. The proposal sits in an area allocated as primarily industrial and community development plan. As such, the proposal is a departure from the development plan. Where no reasonable prospect of the site being used for that allocated improvement use can be demonstrated, applications for alternative uses should be treated on their planned merits, having regard to market signals and a relative need for different land uses to support sustainable local communities. Details have been submitted that show that the unit has been vacant since 2013, and despite marketing by local and national estate agencies, the unit remains empty. Alternative sites for the gym have also been looked into, but have not been able to accommodate the requirements of this growing business, which has an established client base within Hodson. The business has outgrown its current premises. Having regards to all of the supporting information provided in this application, individual merits of this application are considered to weigh in favour of the proposals and are recommended for approval. There is no qualifying position of objection in relation to this application.
Is there one council wants to speak on this? The officer's recommendation is to approve. If I move that and second, subject to the conditions listed, all those in favour? That's unanimous. We now move to agenda item 7, agenda item 6 in the time visit, Norton Court 154, Burberry, pages 33 to 33.
I know something was mentioned about Bell Row as I walked in earlier.
It has been deferred for site visit.
It's been at the next committee now.
32 Bell Row?
Yes.
It's been deferred for a site visit.
Okay, well,
you've got some time.
Thank you. So, agenda item 7, pages 33 to 38, Matthew, can have a presentation.
Planning Commission is the law for the conversion and extension of the existing building from 15 apartments with ground floor retail space into 22 one-bedroom apartments with ancillary accommodation for staff. The new apartments will provide an assisted living facility for residents who have learning or physical disabilities. The ground floor retail units have been vacant since the building was first built in 2006. They have been subject to ongoing marketing with little success. Most recently, the units have been marketed since August 2015, with no interest in the units being brought forward for their permitted use. Given that these units have been empty for 10 years and their proximity to other residential units, it is considered that residential use of ground floor is acceptable and policy SH3 can be relaxed in this instance. The small-scale extensions providing dormers and roof space and a single-storey rear garden room for shared use of residents are considered acceptable and would not result in overlooking loss of privacy or harm to the street scene. There have been no objections to these proposals and as such they are recommended for approval.
Thank you, Matthew. Is there one council wants to speak in this? Can I move it up to committee, please?
We will approve the chair.
Thank you, Dave. We've got a seconder, so has a move in the seconder to approve subject to the conditions listed. All those in favour? We now move to agenda item 8, pages 38 to 42, 23, Walsh and Bergen. Matthew, can I have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. Planning Commission has sought the various extensions and alterations to this attached property. The proposals involve The extensions would not be visible from the street scene, and all standard separation distances are maintained, ensuring no loss of privacy or overlooking. Windows and proposed dormers will be obscured, glazed, and conditioned as such. The proposals are recommended for approval, and there is no objection.
Would
there
anyone asking to speak on this side?
Planning permission is sought for a two-storey side extension, rear dormer extension and front porch extension. An existing single-storey side extension will be incorporated into the side extension, which will provide for two additional bedrooms at first floor. The extension will not be any closer to the boundary with two bracket posts, and there will be no windows for gable elevation of the new extension, which also has a lower ridge line and is set back at first floor level to comply with the policy HS11 on house extensions. The plans have been amended to remove the front door as originally proposed and to significantly reduce the scale of the rear dormer. The rear dormer could now be built using permitted development rights and as such is acceptable. Standard separation distances are all maintained, ensuring privacy and overlooking would not result. The proposals have been designed to appear subordinate to the main dwelling, and the character of the area would not be harmed if the extensions were approved. An earlier approval for a very similar two-storey side extension, a front porch extension, was approved in 2008. As I say, those proposals are closely in keeping with the proposals that are now being considered this evening. Although windows on the proposed gable, there were windows on the proposed gable at that proposal, which have been deleted in this scheme. There's no petition for objection, and the proposals are recommended for approval.
We don't have a board council to speak on this, so that is up to committee. As it's been approved, all to our second account, please give a second up. All those in favour, subject to conditions listed. That's unanimous. Thank you. We move on to agenda item 10, pages 49 to 52, 6 Morgan's Avenue, Bromborough. I think we have a presentation, please.
Again, planning permission is sought for extensions and alterations to the rear of the semi-detached property. A first floor extension is proposed above an extended ground floor kitchen and garden room and above the existing garage, which will be converted into habitable. The extension was alongside an existing garage which abuts the boundary at 4 Moreland Avenue, and as such, together with the roof pitch proposed on the extension, the bulk of the development would be obscured by the existing garage. No windows would overlook the neighbouring properties, and the assessment relating to potential for loss of light has been made, and impacts are considered to be acceptable and not result in any level of harm to amenities that would warrant a refusal of planning permission. The application is recommended for approval, and there is no additional objection to this application.
Thank you, Matthew. Is there more counsel here? So I open it up to committee. Kathleen, move approval. Eddie, move second up. All those in favour, subject to the conditions listed. That's unanimous. That's carried. We can now move to agenda